that, the direct, the chief executives put in new quarterly performance meetings where myself and the chief exec will challenge the individual directors as to their performance, which includes finance, HR, audit, risk management, and also some specific areas as well. So things like the local housing targets, how they get involved with children safeguarding inspections, that kind of thing. We also have a compliance review group, which is a subgroup of the corporate governance group, which looks at specific things, mainly around sort of finance and HR, some of the ideas, the areas we've looked at there on page 81. Overview and scrutiny, obviously, we also call it into account officers to ask them how they are complying and how their performance is monitored, and they have an obligation to scrutinise that. And there's also a series of things that we have in terms of governance. We have the annual governance statement. Directors have to fill in a specific statement on self-assessment to say they are complying with legal obligations. I have a separate one myself, and we have the corporate governance group as well that actually tests some of these. And alongside that, we have some other specific meetings and boards that we set up. So where we need to explore things further, we have a separate meeting for those as well. And then we have a bit of external public scrutiny that I mentioned before, which was things like the Ofsted inspection, Ofsted report.
Sure. Sorry to cut you across. Yeah, there's each director doing an annual governance statement. Do we see those?
We don't see them specifically. They form part of the annual governance statement that Mark will bring at the end of the year. So we don't see them individually. They come as a part of evidence of that.
So we as a committee don't see the governance statement that each of the chief officers have made around the areas? And that, I'm presuming that covers off things like the key expectations across that directors and where they've self-assessed them against those.
It does, and there's a specific question in there about complying with legal obligations as well, so they have to say that they have or they haven't complied with those legal and statutory duties.
Okay, interesting. Yep.
So in those sections really, I'm trying to provide you with, say, some examples of where we test whether legal and statutory duties are being complied with. I think what was apparent, and there's a couple of examples at the end there, but I think what was become apparent as we were trying to produce this report, which is why I've tried to have a go at it a couple of times, is in Appendix 1 it gives you a list of all the legal and statutory duties. There's around 3,000 of them. And what we don't have are outcome measures to say whether we have complied with those individual legal or statutory duties. And some services will have them for some of those duties. We don't have a complete list, a full list of where we are, what we can actually provide assurance via those specific outcome measures. So we discussed this with the leadership team, with the chief exec, before the report was published. And we need to do, I think we do need to do a little piece of work to actually try and develop some outcome measures and some internal performance indicators to say, well, actually, how do we know and what's the direction of travel with those outcome measures? Some of those legal duties that are in Appendix 1, we can just actually tick because, for example, one of them is the council must employ a director of public health. So we've got one, so that's ticked. I guess it doesn't tell you is whether the director of public health is effective in that role or not. The way that we get the assurance that they're effective is by some of the other things that I've provided, so things like appraisals and stuff like that. So I'm happy to take questions on the report as it is, but I think it's evident that I haven't been able to provide the information that the chair wanted in its original format, and there is another piece of work that we need to do and bring something back on
that. That seems like a really good summary. Comments, thoughts? No? Philip?
I suppose I've gone through the list of 102 pages of things we're supposed to do. It's enough to bring back memories, because years ago when we were committees, we used to get very detailed reports of all sorts of things, food inspections, visits and the like. So there's always an issue for members as to how much we want to delve into areas and find out just what staff do and what our duties are. Because having gone through the list, fascinating things like finding out whether there's less a range of stuff in there. Frankly, each year the Local Government Association have a sort of a day in the life of the local council exercise, which may involve tweets, which I don't bother with, but if the public out there appreciated all that the councils do in all sorts of service areas that they take for granted, they're the bread and butter of what we're up to. Except that elected members only see the tip of it, but officers are faced with this vast array of things every day. So I'm trying to work out if we had performance
Okay, and we're asked to note this and we await this further report.
Yes.
At some point. Okay. I know the Chief Executive can have something as well, isn't it?
Yes.
That would be lovely. Thank you very much for your work on that. We did manage to get it in before the end of the year. So well done. External audit committee progress report, pages 217 to 236. Away you go.
Thank you, Chair. As you will notice, I am not a banker.
Are you not?
No. And you'll notice on page 218, where we detail the team members, that Robin is no longer the audit partner for yourselves.
What's he done wrong?
He's done nothing wrong. To stick with the rotation clause of the ethical standards, he's now moved on. And Mark Heap has now become your audit engagement lead. He's based in our Manchester office and has many years' experience in local government and health, and has a number of audits in the area as well. And he sends his apologies for not being able to make today's meeting. I'm your audit manager, Naomi, and I took over partway through last year. I've come to a couple of meetings already, and Becky is our in charge auditor who will be leading the on site audit. And so I just want to draw your attention really to some of the key audit significant risks for this year, which are highlighted on page 219. They are a continuation of the risks we identified last year, the valuation of land and buildings, pension liability, funds liability, and the management override of controls, which is unique to all, which is to all audits. Then drawing on to the value for money arrangements, we've just identified the one significant risk this year, which is the financial planning and sustainability, which continues on from previous years. You're continuing challenging financial position. So we'll look at the arrangements in place to monitor and budget planning as far as this is concerned. We're not able to, as far as logistics are concerned, we're not able to actually pinpoint the specific date for our main audit this year. It will take place sometime between June and September, as we've pointed out already. This is due to just a continuous review of the audits going on throughout our public sector at the moment, and the difficulties we're facing with resources throughout the country.
So do we get a discount?
Unfortunately not.
Oh,
I think the main thing to point out here is that the engagement leaders will not sign the opinion until we're satisfied that the work has been completed, and we have the assurance, as you know from last year, the increased scrutiny that we're facing, the quality of our work, just continual improvement and being enforced. We're subject to many reviews, as you're well aware, the reviews undergoing the public sector audit at the moment. We expect to bring something to the next committee meeting in more detail over that, that will also hopefully answer your queries raised earlier about what the key risks are facing yourselves.
Okay, lovely. Well, that's really helpful, Naomi. Anyone got any questions for Naomi about around any of this? It all sounds like good stuff. Yeah, hopefully you'll get the accounts on enough on time this time. Is that right?
No.
You don't? Okay. Maybe you will then. All right. So I know a lot of work's been going on there. Well, I think that's it, everyone. It just leaves me to thank everyone for their. Certainly all the officers for their hard work, support of this committee over the last 12 months. It's been really interesting, I think, probably a few extra hours thrown in, but it's been really interesting, and thank you everyone for the support that you've given me and the committee, and also to thank members of the committee, because in the main, I think we've managed to act in a kind of collaborative way, non-partisan way, actually just trying to get to what the situation is, and then once we know the position, we can start trying to help. So I think we've done some good work this year. So I wanted to thank everyone for that and for their willingness to participate, as I say, in this non-partisan way, Stuart. And Naomi, can I thank you and your team for coming on too. Thank you very much, everyone.
What about the coronavirus item?
Just going to do Stuart's AOB. Do you want the cameras on or off?